which is the session The Man and the Mahatma. The session is presented by DNA, and welcome with me on stage, please, our speakers for this session, Pramod Kapoor, Nand, Kishore, Acharya, and they are in conversation with Pushpesh, Pant, and we are still waiting for Makarand. Oh, he's there? Okay, so everybody's here. We can start with the session, and yes, enjoy.
Everybody, I think we'll begin immediately. We have a short one-hour session, and there are three speakers. My job is very easy. There is the subject, which is so engrossing that no introduction is actually required. The title has it all, The Man and the Mahatma. Some believe that the Mahatma overshadows the man, and some believe that the man was messy enough to create a mess for all the would-be biographers, interpreters, and so on. He wrote his autobiography called Experiments with Truth. And I would request Pramod, my dear friend and publisher, my publisher also, to begin this, because he has titled his book very interestingly. Makarand has titled his book very interestingly also, but that is Afterlife. And Pramod's book is titled His Experiments with Gandhi. So I would like to begin by asking Pramod to tell us, why did he think of experimenting on a subject which has been much too experimented with?
Well, thank you, Dr. Pant. You know, it indeed is a is an experiment for me, because I'm a publisher, and I knew Gandhi as much as, or probably less than most of you sitting here 4 years ago. It was purely a publisher's instinct that I thought of doing an illustrated book on Gandhi, having done a book called Men Who Killed Gandhi by Manohar Malgaonkar, which I put some photographs and documents, and we extensively researched it. We went to Pune and met Gopal Godse's descendants and the jailer and so on. Anyway, that's a different story. And then I did, I illustrated Kushwant Singh's train to Pakistan with some photographs that we found of Margaret Bourke-White. And those two were very successful, so I said my third attempt should be to illustrate Gandhi's autobiography. Little did I know what I was getting into, because I, as I said, I grew up on Raghupati Raghav Raja Ram, the photographs at home, and that's about all. I mean, and a little bit that everyone knows in school. And once I started to research, I found that this is not just another book, and this is not just another subject. So I went to my friend Professor Mushirul Hasan, and I said, "You have to help me, because I think I've gone the wrong path. I shouldn't have done this." He said, "Look, if you really are serious, you know, go and read the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi." I didn't know how many volumes there were. I thought maybe one or two volumes. But believe me, in the next 9 months, just changed my life. I read 100 odd volumes in 9 months. Of course, speed reading it and making my notes making it easier these days with electronic devices available to you, and created my own selected works. And that sort of started me going on. And I realized that, you know, Gandhi, though he stands where he is, a man or a Mahatma, but he's analyzed every generation, every 10 years, I would say, in differently by different people. People judge him by their own personality rather than by his personality, because I think that there are several reasons for this. I mean, he said that his life was an open book, so there was so much written about him. He wrote so much about others and about himself. He probably wrote, I don't know, 10, 20 lakh letters and received three times more. He was a compulsive letter writer. If he didn't, and then I realized that he was ambidextrous. You know, he could write with both the hands. He often wrote that my right hand is tired, so I'm writing with left hand. Which were, you know, these are small things that got me going. I said, you know, he has a man. But then I also realized that there was a bit of Mahatma in him. There was a bit of man in him. You know, he was given the title of Mahatma by Gurudev. But there are, of course, many more people say that, you know, there are other people also who claim that. But popularly it's known that he was called Mahatma by Rabindranath Tagore. And I realized that, you know, they say luck favors the brave. So I think he was a very brave man, a very determined man. Thrice the most venomous, the snakes actually crossed over him. A cobra once sat on his body, but never harmed him. And he was quiet. He just let it happen. I mean, these are some of the details. As I said, being ambidextrous. There's then, you know, I remember, I'm just, because I'm a kathakar, I'm a narrator, I'm not a philosopher, I'm not an analyst, so I'm giving you stories that I've come across. Perhaps most of you would know what those stories are, so pardon me if I'm repeating them for you, but, you know, there are this Chori Chora incidents where, you know, these police started to fire in the air, and nobody was getting hurt, and here were the villagers who said, Mahatma Gandhi ki wajah se ye sab goliyan pani ho gayi hain, humko kuch lag hi nahi raha, chalo badho ho ya. And they, of course, they did what they did. They burned the thana and we all know what happened and how Gandhi had to stop his non-cooperation movement. Then there was, of course, sites which intrigued me a lot, you know. Somewhat intrigued me, somewhat I look at it differently. That he was very tough on his family. I remember a letter that I read that he wrote to Badshah of, Badshah was the name, the last name of the Tata Sons. Of Tata Sons. I'm talking about
Tata Sons.
He was a director of Tata Sons. You know, I read it in Pune archive, in Tata archive, where they were at loggerheads, you know, because Tatas were, while he was in South Africa, Tatas were funding him through Gokhale and Tilak, you know. And I think there was a certain part of the board that was not very happy with it. They were calling him dictator, they were calling him, you know, anarchist and so on. And I remember there, he, in reply to one of the letters, he says, look, I slapped my young wife, and through her silent tears, I learned what it takes to be a pacifist, you know, which I thought was intriguing. You have to learn this by slapping your wife, you know. So that, I mean, that's one thing. We all know what he did with his eldest son, Hari Gandhi, where, he was the first one to go to jail in South Africa for his cause. And when the time came, he wanted to go to London to study further law. And Gandhi, because I mean, this is how I interpret it, but perhaps you read it, or one day if my book comes out, you'll read it and you will analyze it yourself, that that he denied him the money just because he said, your cousin, who's older than you, deserves it more. Now, whether Gandhi was protecting his image, or to say that, look, I'm not partisan, I will not favor my own son, but rather give it to my brother's son. This is for everyone else to analyze. I would probably do the same as Gandhiji did, but it's easy said than done, you know. And I think this is what Gandhiji could do and did. there are some very interesting stories between Gandhiji and Tagore. Now, before Gandhiji came here, an advanced party of about 20 of his ashramites from Tolstoy ashram, I think, came here. And they first went to Shantiniketan as guests of Tagore. And Tagore was introduced to Gandhi and Tagore were introduced to each other through C.F. Andrews, if I'm
That's correct.
And incidentally, C.F. Andrews was the only one who used to call Gandhiji Mo, dear Mo. I used to write dear Mo, and then he would say dear Charlie. But the rest of them always called either Babu or Mahatma. They were so close. And they got introduced. As I said, it was Gurudev who gave the title of Mahatma, but when it came to non-cooperation movement, Tagore was not very happy. In fact, he was angry with burning of foreign clothes and asking lawyers to stop practice or asking students to boycott college and school, etc. He was very unhappy, in fact, to the extent that he actually wrote a play called Muktadhara, which I think he did not stage because Gandhiji went to jail by that time, if I'm right. But anyway, he wrote a play which everyone in the, expressing dissent. And once when Gandhiji had gone to Calcutta to perhaps persuade Tagore, that was at the height of non-cooperation movement, Tagore called him to the veranda and he said, look, just look downstairs. These are your non-cooperation activists whom you call peaceful. This is where, right in front of my house, while we are talking, they are burning clothes just to spite me. Is that what it? So there were these people, and yet they were such good friends. They would in fact disagree and agree in public. There was nothing behind the friendship between Tagore and Gandhi can be summed up by a couple of things. Where Gandhiji always used to be very possessive about his friends, be it Motilal Nehru or Tagore or many other. I mean, Rajaji, who later became his friend, he used to tell Tagore that you shouldn't eat this luchi. This is made of pure white flour, which is fried in ghee, and it's not good for you. And Tagore instantly replied that, look, I've been having this slow poison for 50 years, that keeps me healthy. So, this is the kind of, there was another incident where he used to tell Motilalji not to drink. And he said, this is evil, this is bad. And Motilalji would publicly say, I mean, this was in the beginning. Later, he stopped drinking because of Gandhiji. But he said in public that water is distilled once, whiskey is distilled thrice. So why can't I have it? And so these are the kind of friendship anyway, perhaps I'm digressing from.
Can I ask you one thing?
Yeah.
These stories are brilliant, and you are bringing out some aspects which are, sort of not debunking the myth making around Gandhi, but restoring the balance. You are reminding us of Mohan, the man who was probably more interesting than Mahatma subsequently became. But could you just share with us, and I think I expect all of you to give within the 15-minute limit within an hour so we can have a Q&A. Could you just conclude by telling us, what did you find most problematic in your exertions, your experiments?
I was coming to that, and I thought I'll put it at the end because I have no answer, and I think a lot of, I think the most difficult and most thing that I have not been able to find answer to is Gandhi sleeping naked with his young niece. Or for that matter, having, I would say names because these are all in books. Dr. Sushila Nair, giving him bath naked. Now, there were several explanations have been given to me by Gandhi scholars, but I think they all are awkward answering this question. Nobody could, somebody said about Ardhanarishwara and someone said about some, but I haven't understood why this. In fact, at the height of Noakhali movement, when he was trying to pacify Hindu and Muslims in the eastern part of India, he was doing this experiment. He was sleeping with Manu Ben, who was his grandniece. And in fact, a lot of people wrote that there were two people, Sudhir Ghosh, I think, who left. He was his interpreter, looking at what was happening, he left. There was Parasuram, his PA, who wrote a 10-page scathing letter about all this and said, I can't handle all this. You're a Mahatma and you're in that. And there were I'm trying to remember, there were, I think, Vinoba Bhave or few other people. Rajaji wrote to him, saying that it's all right, it's your experiment, you're saying, and he used to be very open about it. He would go to public and say, yes, I'm doing this experiment. He would write about it to friends. I think Rajaji or somewhere, I can't exactly remember the name, but he said that, okay, you are doing your experiment, but what about that young girl? What is her future, And he had no answer. He said, of course, I'll stop doing this experiment if all my friends. So that's my biggest discomfort.
I thank you very much, Pramod. I think this is where this experiment will cease with and move to the next speaker. And the next speaker, as far as I'm concerned, is quite contrapuntal. If Pramod has discovered the most interesting part of Gandhi, including his public sex life in mid-50s, there's Professor Acharya and Kishore Acharya, who's studied Gandhi and is a scholar of Gandhian way of life. Two of his recent books are Sabhyata ke Vikalp or Satyagraha ki Sanskriti. So I will ask you to in pustakon par Gandhi ke bare mein agrod mera aap se binti hai ki 15 minute ke bhitar agar ho
10 minute mein karun
nahi 10 na kare kripa karke
bhai maine zyada time le liya
bilkul you are quite all right
mitro Gandhi mein meri ruchi mere bachpan se rahi aur mujhe jo sabse adhik jis vakya ne prabhavit kiya unke bare mein wo tha ki mera jeevan hi mera sandesh लेकिन जब जीवन की हम व्याख्या करते हैं तो केवल वो निजी जीवन नहीं होता वो पूरे जीवन के साथ बाहर के जीवन के साथ भी उनका क्या संबंध है और उनके विचार भी उस जीवन का एक हिस्सा है तो इसलिए एक टोटल गांधी के बारे में हम बात कर सकते हैं अगर मैं क्योंकि मुझे बात बहुत संक्षेप में करनी है इसलिए मैं एक वाक्य से शुरू करता हूँ कि अगर मुझे गांधी के बारे में कुछ कहना हो तो मैं ना उनको महात्मा की तरह देखता हूँ ना मैं उनको किसी साधारण व्यक्ति की तरह मैं इनकी तरह देखता हूँ वो मैं उन्हें एक विद्रोही व्यक्तित्व के रूप में देखता हूँ जो शायद बहुत से लोगों का आश्चर्य होगा अगर मैं ये कहूँ कि गांधी हिज वाज एसेंशियली ए रेबेल पर्सनैलिटी ये सब लोगों के लिए आश्चर्य की बात क्यों सब लोग उनको बहुत ट्रेडिशनल परंपरा के साथ जुड़ा हुआ इत्यादि मानते हैं और ये मैं क्यों कह रहा हूँ ही वॉज ए रेबेल अगेंस्ट एनी काइंड ऑफ इनजस्टिस एनी काइंड ऑफ अनट्रुथ जहाँ भी उनको अन्याय दिखाई देता है वो उसके विरुद्ध विद्रोह करते हैं और ये विद्रोह पूरे जीवन भर चलता है हमने विद्रोही की एक परिभाषा अपने दिमाग में बना रखी है कि वो वायलेंट होगा वो कुछ तोड़फोड़ करेगा मारपीट करेगा खून बहाएगा लेकिन वो विद्रोह की इस अवधारणा के विरुद्ध भी विद्रोह करते हैं और वह ये मानते हैं कि विद्रोह केवल वायलेंट नहीं होता वो नॉन वायलेंट भी होता है अहिंसक भी होता है इसीलिए वो उसे सत्याग्रह दिखने में एक पॉजिटिव शब्द दिखता है सत्य पर आग्रह पर वस्तुतः उसका अर्थ एक विद्रोह है जहाँ भी आपको असत्य दिखाई देता है उसके खिलाफ विद्रोह करना गांधी का मर्म है और यह मर्म उनके बचपन से दिखाई देता है उनके दक्षिण अफ्रीका में क्या कर रहे हैं आखिर विद्रोही तो कर रहे हैं सारी व्यवस्था के विरुद्ध इसके अलावा क्या किया है और वो विद्रोह इस तरीके से कर रहे हैं जिसमें अधिक से अधिक लोग शामिल हो सकें वो व्यक्तिगत विद्रोही नहीं है केवल वो अपने विद्रोह को व्यापक बनाना चाहते हैं और उसके लिए पूरे समाज को अपने साथ लेना चाहते हैं हिंदुस्तान में जब आकर के वो शुरू करते हैं तो कांग्रेस का जो एलिटिसिज्म है उसके खिलाफ उनका पहला विद्रोह है उससे पहले कांग्रेस सामान्य जन के लिए खुली नहीं थी लेकिन गांधी के कारण से वो सामान्य जन के खुली और उनके आंदोलनों में सामान्य जन शामिल होना शुरू है चाहे आप चंपारण में देखिए चाहे आप खेड़ा में देखिए चाहे आप उसके बाद नॉन कॉपरेशन मूवमेंट क्या है वो एक पूरी ब्रिटिश व्यवस्था के खिलाफ एक तरह का विद्रोह है और घोषित विद्रोही कहकर के कह रहे हैं कि मैं विद्रोह कर रहा हूँ उन्हें किसी बात सामान्यतः विद्रोही अपने को छुपाते हैं, अपनी बातों को गुप्त रखते हैं। गांधी खुलकर के विद्रोह कहते हैं और कहते हैं मैं करूंगा। मैं एक आपको छोटा सा उदाहरण देता हूं। तिलक भी बड़े विद्रोही थे और बड़े व्यक्तित्व हैं हमारे देश के और इतिहास के। तिलक को एक केस में सेडिशन का मुकदमा चला उनके ऊपर बॉम्बे हाईकोर्ट, और जब ये सेडिशन का मुकदमा तिलक पे चला तो जिन्ना उनके वकील थे, बहुत से लोगों का आश्चर्य होगा ये जानकर कि जिन्ना उनके वकील थे और जिन्ना ने जो आर्गुमेंट दिया वहाँ पर, जिसमें उस मुकदमे में छूट गए थे तिलक, बाद में वो दूसरे मुकदमे में फंसाए गए और उस मुकदमे में वो छूट गए थे, और छूटने का कारण था जिन्ना का आर्गुमेंट। जिन्ना ने ये कहा कि तिलक जो है वो राज्य के खिलाफ नहीं बोल रहे, वो ब्रिटिश राज्य के खिलाफ नहीं बोल रहे हैं, वो बोल रहे हैं एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन के खिलाफ, और एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन के खिलाफ पॉलिटिक्स में बोला जा सकता है, और ब्रिटिश लोग तो मानते हैं कि एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन के खिलाफ बोलने में घर नहीं है, डेमोक्रेटिक है, तो वो प्रशासन के विरुद्ध बोल रहे हैं, वो राज्य के खिलाफ नहीं बोल रहे हैं। और जज ने इस आर्गुमेंट को स्वीकार करते तिलक को उस मुकदमे में बरी कर दिया। अब आप गांधी का देखिए, यानी जिन्ना एक वकील थे, आप जानते हैं वकील लोग क्या क्या कर सकते हैं, हम सब जानते हैं, तो वो एक तर्क को घुमा करके उन्होंने, लेकिन वकील का संबंध अपने क्लाइंट को छुड़ाने से होता है, सत्य से नहीं होता। क्या तिलक ब्रिटिश राज्य के खिलाफ विद्रोह नहीं कर रहे थे, और नहीं तो क्या कर रहे थे? लेकिन दूसरी ओर जब गांधी अरेस्ट किए जाते हैं और उनसे कहा जाता है कि क्या आप ये चार्ज स्वीकार करते हैं, तो कहते हैं मैं करता हूं, और अगर आप मुझे छोड़ देंगे तो मैं फिर ये करूंगा, क्योंकि ब्रिटिश राज्य को मैं यहां पर अन्याय मानता हूं। ये होता है विद्रोह। और इसका असर क्या हुआ, इस स्टेटमेंट का आप समझिए असर क्या हुआ, कि पूरे देश में एक निर्भीकता आ गई कि हाँ हम खुल के कह सकते हैं कि हाँ हम आपके शासन को नहीं स्वीकार करना चाहते, हम आपके प्रति विद्रोह करते हैं। और नॉन कोऑपरेशन उस विद्रोह की बड़ी भूमिका थी। ठीक यही काम आप देखेंगे कि बाद में वो भारत छोड़ो आंदोलन के समय करते हैं, यानी अगर आप पूरे डिटेल में जाने की आवश्यकता नहीं है, आप सब लोग जानते हैं उन डिटेल्स को, तो ये सारे आंदोलन एक प्रकार से ब्रिटिश राज्य के खिलाफ विद्रोह हैं। ये उनका पहला विद्रोह। दूसरे आप देखिए कि वो केवल ब्रिटिश राज्य के खिलाफ विद्रोह नहीं कर रहे, मैंने अपनी पुस्तक का नाम रखा है सभ्यता का विकल्प, इसलिए रखा है क्योंकि वो पूरी मॉडर्न सिविलाइजेशन के प्रति विद्रोह करते हैं। जिस जो बात कहते हुए हम लोग बहुत घबरा जाते हैं, अरे क्या होगा, ये नहीं होगा तो क्या हो जाएगा, वो नहीं होगा तो क्या हो जाएगा, इसके बिना दुनिया में कैसे काम चलेगा, इस सिविलाइजेशन के बिना हम कैसे चल सकते हैं, लेकिन गांधी कहते हैं कि हम इसके बिना चल सकते हैं, और वो चल करके अपने निजी जीवन में भी दिखाते हैं और अपने विचारों में भी दिखाते हैं, जिसका तात्पर्य यह है कि वो पूरी आधुनिक सभ्यता के प्रति विद्रोह करते हैं, और यह मान करके करते हैं कि यह सभ्यता असत्य पर टिकी है, यह सभ्यता अन्याय पर टिकी है, यह सभ्यता दोषों पर टिकी है, हिंसा पर टिकी है, यह सभ्यता व्यक्तिगत स्वार्थों पर टिकी है। तो इन सब चीजों के विरुद्ध वो अपना विचार प्रकट, और विचार ही प्रकट नहीं करते हैं, सारे जो काम अपने जीवन में करते हैं, आश्रम बनाना, ये करना, वो सब उसको उस परस्पेक्टिव में देखिए, उसको उस परिप्रेक्ष्य में देखिए कि उनका पर्पज क्या है। वो एक महात्मा का जीवन बिताने के लिए आश्रम नहीं बना रहे, वो तो उन्होंने कहा है कि अगर मुझे मेरी आध्यात्मिक मुक्ति अगर मुझे दिखता कि कहीं जाकर के मिल सकती है गुफाओं में अकेले में, तो मैं अकेले में जाके किसी गुफा में बैठता, पर मैं जानता हूँ वो मुझे वहाँ नहीं मिल सकती है, वो मुझे इसी समाज में रहते हुए मिल सकती है, इसी समाज में काम करते हुए मिल सकती है, इसलिए हिंदुस्तान की आज़ादी भी मेरे लिए, ये लड़ाई भी मेरे लिए एक आध्यात्मिक साधन है। तो एक प्रकार से आप ये देखेंगे कि पूरा जो हमारा विचार तंत्र है, दूसरे शब्द में हम कहें कि जो पूरी आधुनिकता का जो माइंड सेट है, उसके खिलाफ वो विद्रोह करते हैं, और विचार से भी और अपने लेखन से भी और अपने कार्यों से। लेकिन ये विद्रोह केवल आधुनिक सभ्यता के विरुद्ध ही नहीं है, ये विद्रोह आपकी परंपरा में आ गई, अपने समाज में आ गई विकृतियों के विरुद्ध भी है। अगर वो अस्पृश्यता के सवाल पर, अगर वो कास्ट के सवाल पर, अगर वो स्त्रियों की स्वाधीनता के सवाल पर, पहला व्यक्ति वो है जिसने इतनी बड़ी संख्या में स्त्रियों को एक राजनीतिक आंदोलन में शामिल किया, इससे पहले आप कोई उदाहरण नहीं पाएंगे। पहला व्यक्ति वो है जिसके कारण से इतनी स्त्रियाँ जेल में गई और बड़े बड़े आंदोलनों में हिस्सा लिया, बड़ी अच्छी नेतृत्व उन्होंने दिया। इससे पहले आप देखेंगे दुनिया के इतिहास में स्त्रियों ने कहीं राजनीतिक आंदोलन को नेतृत्व नहीं दिया, वो चाहे समर्थक रही होंगी, लेकिन गांधी जी ने जो आंदोलन चलाया उसमें आप ये पाएंगे कितनी स्त्रियां हैं जो नेता बनी, उन्होंने नेतृत्व दिया, केवल जेल ही नहीं गई, वर्कर ही नहीं रही, बल्कि उन्होंने नेतृत्व दिया और महत्वपूर्ण नेतृत्व दिया। तो इसलिए हम ये कह सकते हैं कि स्त्रियों के प्रति जो समाज में स्थिति थी उसके विरुद्ध वो विद्रोह करते, इसी प्रकार से दलितों के लिए जो स्थिति थी उसके खिलाफ वो विद्रोह करते, जिसमें अम्बेडकर का भी रोल रहा, उनके विचारों का भी कुछ असर, इंटरेक्शन का भी असर उन पर रहा, और लगातार सीखते चले जाते, लगातार वो डेवलप करते चले जाते अपना। तो मैं ये मानता हूँ कि उनका व्यक्तित्व मूलतः एक विद्रोही व्यक्तित्व है। और 1930 में उन्होंने कहा था, उनसे जब पूछा गया कि आज़ादी मिल जाने के बाद आप क्या करेंगे, तो उनका उत्तर था कि मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि आज़ादी मिल जाने के बाद भी मुझे कई तरह की लड़ाइयाँ लड़नी होगी इस देश में। इस देश में जो विकृतियाँ हैं अर्थव्यवस्था में, आप देखिए अर्थव्यवस्था के विरुद्ध विद्रोह करते हैं, केवल सभ्यता के विरुद्ध नहीं, इंडस्ट्रियलिज्म के खिलाफ विद्रोह करते हैं। तो गांधी को मैं मूलतः इन सब चीज़ों को मिला करके अगर देखूँ तो मैं गांधी को मूलतः एक विद्रोही व्यक्तित्व के रूप में देखता हूँ। और ये जो बात अभी आपने सुनी जो अपनी ग्रैंड नीस के साथ में सोने की, प्रॉब्लम हम सब लोगों के साथ ही है, माफ़ कीजिएगा, कि हम सब लोग साधारण लोग हैं और साधारण लोग होने के कारण से हमारी मानसिकता एक साधारण मनोविज्ञान में चलती है। हमें लगता है कि ये कैसे हो सकता है। एक वो व्यक्ति जो इन सारी कुंठाओं से ऊपर उठ चुका हो और एक अंतिम दिनों में, क्या उम्र रही होगी आप अनुमान करिए उनका, उस अंतिम दिनों में सिर्फ वो ये कह रहा है कि मुझे लगता है मैं अभी तक पूरी तरह शायद उस भाव से मुक्त नहीं हो पाया हूँ, काम भाव से, तो मैं हो पाया हूँ कि नहीं हो पाया हूँ इसके लिए मैं एक एक्सपेरिमेंट कर रहा हूँ। और आपके सामने आपको क्या पता चलता अगर एक्सपेरिमेंट करते थे, किसी को कुछ पता नहीं चलता। वो इस अवधारणा के विरुद्ध भी विद्रोह करते हैं और लगातार जो कुछ उनको महसूस हो रहा है वो अखबार में लिखते हैं और बताते हैं कि मुझे क्या महसूस, ठीक है। बाद में राजा जी ने और लोगों ने जब उनसे कहा तो उनको लगा कि ठीक है, अगर लोग ये नहीं चाहते तो मुझे नहीं करना चाहिए।
हम लोग शायद चर्चा इसका कर सकते हैं, मगर जो बुनियादी मुद्दा नंद किशोर जी ने सामने रखा है वो बेहद महत्वपूर्ण है कि चूंकि गांधी जी का व्यक्तित्व मूलतः विद्रोही का था, तो वो व्यक्ति, और इस देश में नियत विद्रोहियों की है कि विद्रोह करने वाला न केवल महात्मा बल्कि कभी कभी भगवान बन जाता है, जैसा महावीर के साथ
उन्होंने बना दिया हुआ।
तो मैं चाहूँगा ये कि अब हम तीसरे वक्ता प्रोफेसर मकरंद परांजपे से मैं अनुरोध करूँगा और उनकी उनकी जो थीसिस है वो खुद बतलाएंगे कि महात्मा का जीवन तो महत्वपूर्ण है ही, महात्मा का मरणोपरांत और उनका जो मिथकीय चित्रण है वो विद्रोही की ही संभावना नहीं है, उसकी क्या कुछ राजनीतिक उपयोगिता और दुरुपयोगिता है। तो मेरे ख्याल में द बुक विच मकरंद हैज रिटन टू माय माइंड इज नॉट सो मच अ बुक ऑन गांधी एज अ पॉलिटिकल ट्रैक फॉर आवर टाइम्स एंड इट इफ आई मे से सो इट इज लोडेड विद आइडियोलॉजिकल कंटेंट विच सॉर्ट ऑफ सेज दैट गांधी वॉज नॉट असैसिनेटेड बट वॉज अ विलिंग पार्टी इन टू हिज एबेटिंग हिज ओन असैसिनेशन एंड इट इज नॉट इम्पॉर्टेंट टू ट्रेस हु किल्ड गांधी रादर देन वॉट किल्ड गांधी एंड हाउ वी कीप किलिंग what he thought yeah. was important for this country. So we have a day, this in this day and age, a lively debate going on in India that if Mr. Modi and BJP takes over power, has taken over power, they are those who killed Gandhi have come to power. So I think I'll let Makarand speak. And 15 minutes, sir.
Thank you so much, Professor Pant. It's wonderful to be here today in this very distinguished panel. And I want to begin by thanking the organizers of this festival for inviting me, especially Namita Gokhale, who's been a friend for such a long time, and we're all grateful to her and her team, and William Dalrymple for showcasing books in this extraordinary way. And it's a very auspicious occasion. Today is Vasant Panchami, to be talking about ideas and books as well. So this is the book, it's called The Death and Afterlife of Mahatma Gandhi. And apropos the title of this panel today, The Man and the Mahatma, I'd like to sum it up, or sum up my response, by saying that Gandhi is the man whom everyone loves to hate. And Gandhi, the Mahatma, is somebody whom everyone hates to love, you know? So this is the little paradox I'm gonna throw your way. But as Professor Pant was saying, this book is really about the meaning of Gandhi's death or the meaning of Gandhi's murder, because I believe that this is something that this nation, especially the Hindus of this nation, don't want to confront. And it's one of those repressed, you might say, birth traumas of our country. In fact, What I argue in this book is that India's birth is characterized by two traumas. One is the partition, of course, and the other is the murder of the so-called father of the nation. And Godse in his trial actually gives a very Oedipal spin to his act by saying that he killed the father of the nation for being, you might say, unfaithful to the motherland. And he was partial to the other, not the mother, but the other, which was obviously Pakistan, you see. So this is the son of Mother India rising to kill the errant or the cheating father. So there is this Oedipal implication to this, and there is this enormous repression of the killing of the Mahatma, which this book is trying to come to terms with, because what I argue in this book is that the partition is a never-ending mimetic cycle of violence and retaliatory violence, which Gandhi wanted to stop. So we are living through a continuous partition, which is being replicated in communal violence and also in this never-ending war with Pakistan. You know, we think that we had three or four wars, but actually it's a never-ending war. There are people dying on the border every day. And Gandhi realized this, that if Hindus and Muslims do not find a way to live together, then this illogic of partition, the illogic of the two-nation theory, which he wanted to refute, will play itself over and over again till we are destroyed. And this is, in a way, the secret of Gandhi's death, what he died for. So as Professor Pant said, I do argue that Gandhi co-scripted his own assassination. In other words, that Godse and company thought that they were killing Gandhi, but Gandhi was also preparing for his own death. So the second part of the book is called, it's actually about the last days of Gandhi in Delhi, the 133 days he spent in Delhi. He arrived there on the 9th of September in 1947, and he was murdered on the 30th of January 1948. And he had just stopped the rioting and communal violence in Calcutta, and then he came to Delhi. And actually he wanted to go to Pakistan because he knew what was happening there. But he stopped in Delhi because Delhi was in flames. The refugees had come to Delhi, and there was a fear. Muslims had left their homes and shops, and they were preparing to go to Pakistan. And there was a fear that Delhi would, you know, have a Holocaust. There would be a conflagration in Delhi because many of the refugees who had come were very angry and they had experienced incredible atrocities. They had lost their loved ones. Their women and their families had been raped and abducted. And Gandhi was aware of all this. So he said that he was starting the last yajna of his life. Yajna is this sacrificial ritual. And he said that he was preparing for that. So the last 133 days were Gandhi's last, as it were, great yajna, this public sacrifice. And when we, in the Vedic ritual, you offer things, the ahuti in this yajna, the fire offering, the oblations which rise to the heavens and in that sense transform the earth, they change the energy. That was the old yogic idea of the yajna. So what was the most precious thing he could offer in this yajna? The yajna to stop this bloodshed, and the bloodshed which was threatening the freedom of India, which was the most precious thing that India had earned after so much sacrifice and struggle. And what was the most precious thing that could be offered in this ritual fire? And it reminds us of the sacrifice of this other great saint in Delhi, Guru Tegh Bahadur, because when Aurangzeb was killing the Brahmins, actually, you know, and he had heaped the Yagnopavits, Guru Tegh Bahadur said, how do we stop this injustice? How do we stop this killing? And he said to himself, that's what the legend tells you, that if some really pure and holy man or holy soul offers his life to end this injustice, then it would stop. And his very young son said, who could be better than you, Dad? I mean, like, who is, you know, a better human being, more virtuous and holier than you? So he offered his life. And in the first part of the book, I say that Gandhi is the only other man, only other person who has two memorials, you know, one to his worldly or secular power, Rajghat, and the other to his spiritual power, which is Gandhi Smriti. Like Guru Tegh Bahadur has two gurdwaras, you know, Sheesh Ganj, where his head was felled, and Rakab Ganj, for his body, where the body was cremated. So Gandhi is the other person like that, who combines Miri Piri, you know. Anyhow, so Gandhi said, what's the most precious thing I can offer in this oblation? And it was his own life. So like this ancient Vedic sage, Dadich, who offered his bones so that the asuras could be defeated, Gandhi put his body, in a sense, he didn't put a spanner in the works of this repetitive and mimetic violence of the partition, the never-ending partition. He put a skeleton in the works, as it were, not a spanner in the works. He stopped the engine of partition. So he co-scripted his assassination. So here Godse was thinking he was going to kill the old man. But I argue here, there's no Indian Oedipus, you see. So Freud was wrong, within quotes, because Freud thought there was Oedipus was a universal symbol. And others have done research on this, Alan Dundee's and Ramanujan, and I quote them, and I say there's no Indian Oedipus. There's no story of patricide in India, and whenever there is, it's reversible. Like Arjun's son kills Arjun, but then Ulupi comes and Arjun is revived. In some versions, in the Kritivas Ramayana, Love and Kush kill Rama, but it's a misunderstanding and there's a revival. So I argue that in the Indian tradition, the Hindu tradition, the geriatrics always win. You see, so Bhishma tells, Shikhandi thinks he kills Bhishma, but Arjun's arrow strike deepest. So he tells Arjun, you know what, only you could kill me, but only when I allowed you to. So what happens is that Godse thinks he's killing Gandhi, but Gandhi is smarter than him, so he reverses it and he says, you can kill me only because I allow you to kill me. Because 10 days before Gandhi is actually shot, the same group of conspirators, they try to kill him. There's a bomb attempt and it fails. And one of the conspirators, Madanlal Pawa, is captured and he tells the Delhi police who the killers are. And there's a botched up investigation. And both B.G. Kher as well as Morarji Desai have reliable, credible information that there's a plot afoot to kill Mahatma Gandhi. But they don't do it. They are incompetent. And Justice Khosla has uncovered all this. And so has Manohar Malgaonkar in the book that Mr. Kapoor published. So all this is known. So who killed Gandhi? It's not only Godse or the ideology, but the Congress government failed to protect him after a bomb attempt. Because just 2 days before Gandhi was assassinated, he wrote his last will and testament, where he said the Congress party should be dissolved because we won independence and the Congress workers should fan out and create this sort of parallel mechanism to check the government and the administration and to ensure that they're serving the people. But Congress people wanted the spoils of power. They didn't want to give up power. So Gandhi had become irrelevant. So in other words, the responsibility for killing Gandhi rests not only with one group of people or with an ideology, but it extends not only to the Congress government, which was ruled by his own acolytes and followers, but to several people, all of us, in fact, who found the old man inconvenient, irrelevant. And so I'm arguing that Gandhi co-scripts his assassination because he's looking for an exit plan. And every day of those 133 days, he's talking about his death. And he tells Manu, he says, if I die of anything from a pimple to pneumonia, proclaim to the whole world I'm no Mahatma, then I was a complete fake and a fraud. But if I die with bullets on my chest, you know, and when we went to the Gandhi Smriti, I took a class there, I taught a course, and some of these ideas came from that course. I want to remember my own students at Jawaharlal Nehru University. And I remember the director of Gandhi Smriti, who then was Savita Singh, she said Gandhi died with a garland of bullets around his neck, you know. So he was a brave man, as Mr. Kapoor said, and as Mr. Acharya also said. So he faced these bullets like a warrior. You know, in Rajasthan, they say that when these people went out to fight, the wives, when they came back, they didn't open the fort doors, and they said, show me where the wounds are. So if the wounds were on the back, they said, you know, get lost. You came back running, you know. But if the wounds were in the front, they said, okay, come back home. So this man died with the bullets. He took the bullets to his chest, and he had this exit plan. And the exit plan was to offer himself against the logic of never-ending partition. So this is the argument of this book. And you might ask, how do you define a Mahatma? So I say, a Mahatma is defined as somebody whose afterlife is greater than his life. So in
well
some
said.
Ways,
well said.
You know, when we talk about Ram and, you know, all of that, Ram is not important. Ram, Naam is more important than Ram. So Ram kya karenge pata nahi, lekin Ram Naam to paar kar dega, you know. So it's like that. So Gandhi, as Munna Bhai says, as Rajkumar Hirani says, you know, this is what I say. One of the chapters in this book, I contrast Attenborough's Gandhi with, so Hollywood and Bollywood. So I say that, you know what Hollywood does, it makes Gandhi a saint, and it's about the life of Gandhi. But what Bollywood does is it's about the afterlife of Gandhi, the specter of Gandhi that haunts the body politic of India. And this is the ghost who walks. The ghost, you can't exorcise the ghost of Gandhi. And it's Sarojini Naidu who said, very interestingly, in her All India Radio broadcast, which was like an obituary to Gandhi, she said, my father, do not rest. You know, let your bones and ashes come to haunt this country. So Gandhi haunts this, the imagination of India. And I'll say just one more thing, because I have 2 minutes of my 15, and then I'll stop, which is that really, what do you do with the death of Gandhi? My point is that the wounds in the psyche of this civilization, Naipaul called us a wounded civilization. The partition is the greatest wound of this civilization. It's the modern Mahabharata, where cousins have fought and destroyed each other. And the murder of Gandhi is directly an outcome of the partition of India. So the twin traumas of the nation can only be healed if we collectively expiate and, you know, do penance for the murder of the father of the nation by finding a new covenant, a new way for Hindus and Muslims to live together. And all his life, Gandhi worked for this. And he started with the dream of Hindu-Muslim unity. And towards the end of his life, he was very disillusioned. And he said, okay, if not unity, then amity.
At least.
And then finally he said, acha, amity bhi nahi, coexistence to karo. So I would propose that is the challenge before us. Let's at least have a new covenant where we learn to coexist. And that is the whole point about this book. And I urge you to read it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We have 15 minutes. We can take a few questions. Then the next session begins almost immediately at the same venue. May I request the questioners to make their questions very brief? We'll greatly appreciate it. And don't go into an involved exchange with the speaker or have a very convoluted question. Though it's open to the floor. The gentleman in the third row with the red jacket.
Good morning, sirs. My question is, Mr. Ambedkar was also a very great person, and a lot of comparisons have been made with him. So do you think that he also deserved the title of a Mahatma or something, because he was also a kind of a...
Thank you. Which one of you would like to answer it?
No, Ambedkar ki mahanta mein koi sandeh nahi hai, aur ek tarah ka vidroh unke andar hai. Lekin ek vidroh wo hota hai jo ek samaj ko baant deta hai. Ek vidroh wo hota hai jo pure samaj ko ek karta hai. Ye dono ke beech ka fark hai. आप ये देखेंगे कि और मैं जब ये सवाल उठाता हूँ तो बहुत से लोग मतलब नाराज होते हैं मुझसे इसलिए मैं ये कहता हूँ कि अंबेडकर का हिंदुस्तान की आज़ादी के आंदोलन में क्या भूमिका है वो जो काम कर रहे हैं एक वर्ग के लिए कर रहे हैं जो इनजस्टिस उसके साथ हुआ है वो वाजिब है उनका गुस्सा भी वाजिब है उनका विद्रोह भी वाजिब है लेकिन एक बड़े विजनरी से हम ये उम्मीद करते हैं कि वो उस गुस्से को उसके कारणों को समझते हुए और एक ऐसा रास्ता निकालेगा जिससे कि बाइफरकेशन ना हो गांधी वो रास्ता निकालने की कोशिश करते हैं, अंबेडकर के आग्रह दूसरे हैं। आप ये पाएंगे कि जिस समय हिंदुस्तान, एक तो वो सत्याग्रह से सहमत नहीं है, किसी तरह के आंदोलन से सहमत नहीं है, वो दलितों के लिए आंदोलन करते हैं आप जानते हैं, लेकिन वो पूरे देश के लिए नहीं करते, पूरे देश की आज़ादी के लिए नहीं करते, उसमें शामिल नहीं होते। फिर दूसरी बात ये गौर करने की है कि थोड़ा सा विस्तार होगा दो मिनट का, आई एम जस्ट गोइंग टू आंसर इट विद इन टू मिनट्स। दूसरी, क्योंकि बड़ा महत्वपूर्ण सवाल है, दूसरी बात इसमें यह है कि जब उनके उनसे पूछा जाता है, साइमन कमीशन के सामने गवाही देते हैं, बहुत कम लोगों को इसके बारे में जानकारी है, तो अम्बेडकर ये कहते हैं कि आदिवासियों को राइट टू वोट देने की जरूरत नहीं है, तो दलितों को क्यों है, तो आदिवासियों को राइट टू वोट देने की जरूरत क्यों नहीं है, वो पढ़े लिखे नहीं है, वो डेमोक्रेसी समझते नहीं है, वो ठीक से नहीं कर पाएंगे, तो आप ये समझिए कि वो क्या कर रहे हैं। फिर जब हिंदुस्तान में सबसे बड़ी लड़ाई लड़ी जा रही है भारत छोड़ो आंदोलन की, उस समय अंबेडकर वायसराय की कार्यकारिणी के मेंबर हैं, रिजाइन भी नहीं करते, बहुत से इंडियन मेंबर्स ने उस समय रिजाइन किया, अंबेडकर रिजाइन, और जब हिंदुस्तान आज़ाद होने होता है तब वो जाते हैं और मिलते हैं चर्चिल से और पूछते हैं हमारा क्या होगा, तो उस समय तक तो ब्रिटिश उनका इस्तेमाल कर रहे थे, अब उनका नहीं, अब हिंदुस्तान आज़ाद है, तुम जानो, तुम्हारी गवर्नमेंट जाने।
तो मैं वही जोड़ने की बात करूंगा, तोड़ने की नहीं। तो मेरा अनुरोध ये है कि हमें गांधी और अंबेडकर दोनों चाहिए आज, और उनमें ऐसे विरोध करके ज़्यादा फ़ायदा नहीं है, उसका फ़ायदा सिर्फ एक पक्ष को होगा, एक वर्ग को होगा। और इसके बारे में एक बहुत खूबसूरत किताब लिखी गई है डीआर नागराज की, जिसमें वो एक कल्पना करते हैं कि दोनों मरणोपरांत मिलते हैं कहाँ, स्वर्ग में, और उनके कमरे साथ साथ है, तो अंबेडकर कहते यार यहाँ भी तेरे साथ ही पल्ला पड़ा मेरा, यू नो। और वहाँ पे तो जो धरती पे उनमें जो सामंजस्य नहीं हो पाया वो वहाँ जाके होता है, वैसे ये कल्पना करते हैं। इट्स कॉल्ड द फ्लेमिंग फीट, ये किताब पढ़ने लायक है, आप पढ़िए ज़रूर। लेकिन हमें दोनों की ज़रूरत है, और दोनों मिलके समाज जोड़ सकते हैं।
नहीं, लेकिन एक बात मैं और कहना चाहूँगा, वो ये कि अंबेडकर पार्टीशन का समर्थन करते हैं
जी।
और समर्थन करते हैं इसलिए कि हिंदू और मुस्लिम साथ नहीं रह सकते।
नहीं, एक भैया,
जबकि गांधी ये नहीं
मानते। प्रश्न का एक सीधा उत्तर है कि उनको महात्मा की उपाधि क्यों नहीं दी जा सकती। महात्मा की उपाधि कोई पद्म सम्मान की श्रृंखला नहीं है,
उनको भारतरत्न मिल गया, गांधी जी को नहीं दिया।
चर्चा में आज ही साबित हो रहा है, किसी को आज ये याद नहीं रह गया कि महात्मा गांधी को पहले किसने कहा था। नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, मैं अपने वक्ताओं से भी अनुरोध करूंगा कि प्रश्न संक्षिप्त हो और उत्तर भी संक्षिप्त हो।
उत्तर सेटिस्फैक्टरी
बिल्कुल, मगर प्रश्न का मौका तो दें।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि अभी जिस तरीके से देश में एक चल रहा है ये एक विवाद कि गॉडसे की मूर्ति लगाई जा रही है, और दूसरे तरफ जो हिंदुस्तान में जो नई जनरेशन आ रही है, दोनों के बीच में जो ये एक डिबेट बन रहा है और जिस पे एक माहौल बन गया है आज की आज के इस मॉडर्न वर्ल्ड में, उस पे क्या कहना चाहेंगे आप?
आई थिंक इट्स अ वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन। जस्ट बिफोर आई वाज कमिंग टू दिस सेशन, सम पीपल वर सेइंग इट्स वेरी टॉपिकल बिकॉज पीपल वांट टू पुट अप स्टैचूज ऑफ गोडसे, यू सी, एंड देयर इज दिस आर्ग्यूमेंट दैट गोडसे साइड हैजंट बीन हर्ड। सो इवन अबाउट द गांधीज एक्सपेरिमेंट्स विद ब्रह्मचार्य और विद द सेक्सुअलिटी, आई हैड समथिंग टू से अबाउट इट, बट maybe we'll have an occasion to come back to that. But, you know, I don't think we should be afraid of criticizing or questioning Gandhi. Gandhi was never afraid. So let Godse's side be, you know, let him get a hearing, let people say what they want to say. And you really find that there's a lot of fabrication around it. Even this play, there was a play on Godse by Dalvi, and it's full of fabrications and half lies And so, you know, as Nand Kishore ji said, I mean, the big thing about Gandhi was truth. So we should not be afraid of truth, right? Whatever the truths are, let them come out. So let there be a debate, and let's see whether by killing Gandhi, the aims that Godse stood for, which was he wanted a Hindu Rashtra, okay? by killing Gandhi, can you create a Hindu Rashtra? What were the reasons behind the killing? I'll just tell you one little thing. He said, I killed Gandhi because he gave away 55 crores of rupees. He insisted, he went on fast. But the first attempt was before that happened. So you see, there's so many factual errors around this.
That's true. And so what I'm saying
is, let there be a debate and let's decide. And I'll even go to the extent of saying, if you want to put up a statue, put up a statue, it's okay. You know, who cares? See, in Kumbakonam, when Periyar took out a procession, all the Indian deities were garlanded with shoes. That doesn't mean people stop going to the temples. Like, we are not Taliban. We don't want to shoot the people or decapitate the people who disagree with us. Yeah.
The next question from the last row.
Also, if I may add, you know, Gandhi towards the end mentioned that whoever kills him will not kill me or kill real Gandhi. He will kill Gandhi that he thinks is a Gandhi.
Exactly.
And not what he perceives as Gandhi, not himself.
Excellent.
Good morning, all of you. My name is Rajesh Kapoor. Whatever you people have said, I completely agree with it. There's just a small little question which I want to ask. And that is, if Mr. Gandhi had been a little more assertive, because he had that mass following, no other leader had. If he would have been a little more assertive, we could have avoided all this.
मुझे लगता है कि शायद ये नहीं होता, क्योंकि उन्होंने बहुत assert करने की कोशिश की और आखिरी मीटिंग में यहाँ तक कहा कि अगर partition होना ही है, तो अंग्रेज ना करें, वो छोड़ दें, हम आपस में मिलकर के करें. But Congress not agree to it. और गांधी से बात करने से पहले वो तय कराए थे कि partition होगा. ये बड़ी प्रॉब्लम थी. और गांधी ने तब ये कहा कांग्रेसमैन को कि अगर आप इनसे डिसएग्री करते हैं तो आप इन लीडर्स को हटा दीजिए और नए लीडर्स चुन लीजिए, अगर आप चुन सकते हैं तो. अगर आप नहीं चुन सकते हैं तो फिर जो आपने लीडर्स चुने, उन्होंने जो तय किया उसको मानिए. ही वॉज नेवर इन फेवर ऑफ पार्टीशन, वो हमेशा से कहते रहे और आखिरी समय तक नहीं थे.
Yes, I'll also add a footnote to this. You see, a lot of people want to blame Gandhi for the partition by saying, why didn't he fast unto death, or why didn't he? And they said, oh, he said, vivisect me before you vivisect India. Now, this quotation is not found in the complete works. What is the source of it? It is K. Munshi's book, Akhanda Bharat. It's attributed to an essay in the Harijan, but it's not there. So, you know, there's so many things, and then there's another one where Maulana Azad also says it, but it's not in the complete works. And if you look at what Gandhi said himself, he says that I don't accept the partition, I'm completely against it. But I can't force the Muslims, you know. If they want partition, how can I force them to say that they shouldn't want partition? I can only say, you know, so what he said is, you cannot coerce people from leaving you. It's not possible, you know. You can persuade them, you can say you love them or whatever, you want to be with them, but you can't coercively stop the partition. So there's a contradiction in terms when people say that Gandhi was responsible, because why didn't he coerce the others to stop the partition? That was Savarkar's way. He said, look, we have the numerical strength, you know, we will fight to make sure it's not partition. But you can't do that, and Gandhi writes about it. He said that at that time, he said there were, whatever, 4 crore Muslims, you know, I mean, and
electorate.
Yeah, so he said, now what do you do? Do you say you drive them all away? No, you can't. Can you kill everybody? No. So what can you do? You have to learn to coexist. And then he says, if you actually drive them away or kill them, then you start killing each other. And that's what has happened in Pakistan. You see, there were 12-13% Hindus at partition. Now there's less than 2%. But does it mean the killing has stopped in Pakistan? No. Muslims are killing Muslims. Shias are killing Sunnis and vice versa. Afghans and Pashtuns are killing other people. Muhajirs are killing others. And so this is the point. There are no others. There are only selves. We are all selves of each other. So there's no self for the dialect.
I'm afraid there is no time for an education.
Just one small point.
No, sir, I'm sorry.
You mean that part of the world is ungovernable, sir?
I'm sorry, sir. You'll forgive me. We don't have a time for a conversation. We have time for just one more question right at the end. One more question and answer.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for your lovely discussion. I had a small question. We're looking at a change where we see coexistence and amity. Are we looking at, because we see a Mahatma-led movement, we see a Guru Tegh making that effort. Are we looking at a people's movement here for change, or are we looking at a person-led movement in future?
What I want to say is actually, you know, this question, if not problem of Hindu-Muslim, whatever, should I say coexistence, amity, or rapprochement, or reconciliation, is a very old one. It's not as recent as the partition, nor is it something that the British created. You know, it goes back to the invasions, to the conquests of India, to the genocides of the Hindus, to the enslavement of Hindus, to conversion, to destruction of temples, to all kinds of things, and it can't be solved easily. It's a 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 1,000-year-old question. And today, the ramifications of some of these questions are international, because there's a crisis in Islam, as we all know, right? Everywhere there is people, even Muslims themselves, don't know like how to solve this problem. What is it that this religion, this community, its ideology, what does it stand for? And how do I want to be a Muslim if I'm a Muslim? You know, things like that. So what I'm saying is it's obviously not an individual question. It's not even an Indian question. It's a global question. And that's where, as Nand Kishore Acharya said, basically Gandhi is not just for India, and it's not only for Hindus and Muslims. Gandhi is for humankind, for the future of humanity, for the survival of the human race. And for the survival of the human race, we have to learn to base not just our polity, right, but our means and modes of production also on sustainability and non-violence of some kind. Otherwise, we're going to destroy the whole habitat which sustains us. And so what I'm saying is the questions that Gandhi raises, even if they have local origins, have global ramifications, including this question of the coexistence of two communities within India and outside of India, the question of, you know, what's happening today between different religious communities or civilizations.
Thank you.
One small footnote. The only one-line footnote, that the solution to every problem according to Gandhi lies in the acceptance of non-violence. That is his creed. And if you accept that creed, that we will solve, or the humanity accepts this creed, there would be conflicts, there would be tussles. But we would solve our tussles only through non-violent means. That is the only solution.
It is my time to have my last sentence, single sentence. I think Gandhi will continue, the ghost of Gandhi, as Makarand says, will continue to haunt us, and is for each one of us to individually decide whether we accept his one sentence encapsulation of his philosophy or not. Thank you very much. It's been a wonderful discussion.
Thank you,
Pramod. Thank you, Makarand. Thank you, Acharya.
Thank you very much for this wonderful session. Pramod Kapoor, Makarand Paranjpe, Nand Kishore Acharya, who were in conversation with Pushpesh Pant. The session, The Man and the Mahatma, was presented by DNA. The authors will be, if you've got your copy of their books, the authors will be available for book signing in the back of this venue over there. So please don't try and get them signed here, but